Hi, I'm back with another vlog, and today we're going to be talking about the second life of Jenny Dembro, aka Genitalia. So everything I'm going to be sharing with you today is from an article by The Standard called The Second Life of the 90s Club Kid, Jenny Dembro. The article was written by Elna Fieldman, and the photographer for the article was Christopher Lehman. This article is very long, so I'm not going to go over the whole thing. I'm just going to share pieces of it, but I will link to it below if you want to read the whole thing. So it starts off, the Queen of the Club Kids is now a part of a different club. It's the 1995 King and Queen of Manhattan pageant at Limelight, New York City's most ultra club, and everyone's on Special K. The MC announces the one, the only, Genitalia. A young woman in a giant blonde wig and a pink dress takes the stage. She proceeds to stomp down the runway, looking both physically and mentally out of this world. Then rips off the blonde wig to reveal her fully shaved head. She won the pageant. This was all captured in Party Monster, the Shockumentary, the 1998 documentary about the rise and demise of the Club Kids. Her real world name is Jenny Dembro, and today the former Calvin Klein model and Jeremy Scott muse is in a totally different club, the Lower East Side Girls Club. She's the club's associate executive director. When people hear our name, they think we're a rec center, she says, but the girls club is maybe the furthest thing from a dusty basketball gym. A recent tour by Dembro took upwards of an hour due to the sheer size of its 35,000 square foot facility. There's a state-of-the-art science lab, complete with high-powered microscopes and lab equipment, a fashion studio where the girls learn the fundamentals of designing and making clothes, a culinary center, art, dance, and yoga studios, a full-on music production studio complete with an Airstream trailer for podcasting. Oh, did we mention the planetarium? There's one of those too. And that's just to name some of the classrooms. The girls' club works to break the cycle of poverty. Walking through its halls with Dembro, there's a palpable joy in the air. Several girls run up to her and give her big hugs. She knows everyone's names, everyone's lives, everyone's schedules. Dembro says, "One of the greatest joys of my work is working alongside former members and seeing them want to give back and work with the next generation." When you hear her life story, it makes so much sense that this club found success and that Dembro is one of the forces behind it. This is the same woman that at age 15 years old became the it girl of the Club Kids, helmed by Michael Alec in the late 1980s, and headquartered primarily at the Limelight. The Club Kids were iconic figures of the New York City nightlife scene, larger-than-life characters with out-of-this-world lifestyle to match. It wasn't one freak in the crowd, they were the crowd, and they were cool. Drugs and sex were a big part of it, yes, but it was about fantasy and escapism. Dembro recounts an outlaw party, saying, "We all took over a subway car and had a party. This cavalcade of freaks took over." Their costumes were also larger than life, very much intended to shock and scare. Dembro was a figure of celebrity-type status on the scene, a style icon with her pierced cheeks, no eyebrows, a shaved head, and tattoos. I was definitely going for an alien, genderless look. Also, when you have a shaved head, it makes it really easy to paint things on it, so it's just more of a canvas. So the article then goes on to describe the appearance that Dembro made on the 1993 episode of The Phil Donahue Show, and it basically describes what is said word for word between her and Donahue. Dembro admits much of the story was a lie. The hiding from her parents thing was very real, but not the Park Avenue type parents or the country house. She grew up on the Upper West Side with two wonderful, wacky parents who had a lot of amazing artists as friends. She remembers going to Patricia Fields and seeing drag queens and some of the colorful downtown characters and dying to be part of it. She said she was always a little different, wearing weird clothes, shaving her head when she was 12, and always looking for her people. She found them when she slept over at her friend's house, snuck out, and got into the VIP section of building. There, she met Michael Alec, Pebbles, Christopher Comp, and the assorted batch of misfits. "My mind was blown," she says, "and the music and fashion, the people being uninhibited and wild and free. Everything spoke to me." From there, she was taken under Alec's wing and became the scene's it girl, hanging with her best friend Jeremy Scott and getting paid just to breathe in a room. That was the magical mystery of that time. You just dressed up and showed up. It wasn't like I was a promoter. I just put a toaster on my head and walked in the door. Space kitchenette. As the club kids were crowning each other the king and queen of Manhattan, they were becoming kings and queens of New York's underground club scene and style icons in the eyes of mainstream. Dembro was flown to Paris to open a Jean-Paul Gaultier show. Madonna closed it. That led to her starring solo in a Calvin Klein ad, the biggest campaign you could book that decade, which appeared in a full page of Vogue and on the side of city buses. After that ad, she stopped modeling. I realized my modeling career was only downhill from there. Eventually, though, as the drugs started to take over, things really did start to go downhill. Not just for her, but for everyone around her. Dembro explains, I went on a downward spiral, but something kind of kept me from completely going into the abyss. That something is her parents, who she says are her best friends. The it's not fun anymore feeling started sinking in for her even before the horrific murder of fellow club kid Andre Angel Melendez by Michael Alec. I was very self-absorbed for so many years, and I just needed something else to focus on. She enrolled in NYU, and it was there that she met Lynn Pentecost, PhD, the Girls Club founder and executive director, who was her professor in a course called Urban Schools in Crisis. Pentecost became Dembro's mentor and asked if she wanted to be part of a club she was starting for girls in the Lower East Side. There were already 3 full-service boys clubs in the neighborhood, and they wanted the same opportunity for girls. Dembro said, yes, please. It's only now, with the perspective of time and change, that she has begun to realize that the club kids were something extraordinary. Now that I'm 41, I don't think it was just youthful exuberance. I think the club kid scene was actually pretty spectacular. She's still in touch with many of the club kids who made it out of the abyss, like Walt Paper, her best friend to this day, and a successful artist. When looking back on those days, she says, I look at the people from that era, and there are ones that didn't make it, or just made some really unfortunate decisions, causing them to crash and burn. And then there were those that rose above it. Whatever didn't kill them made them wiser and more driven, and they are doing some really phenomenal things. She's a member of that club, too. So that's pretty much it for the article. The article itself actually goes into a lot more detail about how the Girls Club was actually built up and some of the other functions of the East Side Girls Club as well. So I will put a link for it below. But I hope you guys enjoyed that article. It was interesting to learn a little more about Jenny Dembro, and it sounds like she is definitely one of the success stories, somebody who has turned their life around. So I hope you guys found that interesting. Thanks again for all the support and the likes and comments, guys. I really appreciate it. And if you haven't yet subscribed, please do so by clicking the kitty, and I will see you again for my next upload.